The Appointed Patterns, Part 2, The Harvests. My name is Daniel Vallis from informedchristians.com, a website ministry devoted to discerning current events from a Christian and biblical perspective. In Part 1, we review different patterns of the feasts and how they point toward the Jewish wedding pattern and the work of redemption that Christ is doing. The feasts are patterns and shadows of the larger picture. Throughout Scripture, there are many pictures and illustrations used to picture the work that Christ is doing and different responsibilities and even what Christians are. And we're just covering a few, but today we're going to look at the harvests. And these are used throughout Scripture to differentiate the different types of people and the different mindsets that spring forth. In the spring feasts, there's Passover, unleavened bread, and firstfruits, as well as Pentecost later on towards summer. Jesus Christ became the first fruits. He fulfilled the pattern that the shadow of that feast was pointing toward. He became the first fruits, and we, likewise, will follow in that pattern. 1 Corinthians 15:20-23. But now is Christ risen from the dead, and become the first fruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. But every man in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterwards they that are Christ at his coming. Christ rose from the dead and became the first fruits, the pattern of the new life. And all those that are Christ and that believe in him and that have Christ as their mediator before God and the Father, we are first fruits after his pattern. And we will be his fruit at his coming. James 1:18, of his own will begat he us with the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. There are many different types of people on earth, and in these last days when Christ is about to return, he's going to find several different groups of people, and they are represented by the different types of harvests. And we've looked at the overall Jewish wedding pattern, which is the picture of the work of redemption that Christ is doing. We have looked at the feasts, which also are a shadow of that larger work. And now we're going to look at the four different harvests and what they represent, and also how they fit in with Christ when he returns. Barley is one of the first fruits of the agricultural season, and it is ready for harvest very early in the year. One of the nice things about barley, though, is it does not take a lot of extensive work. The harvest, you cut it down just like any other, but to process it, all you have to do for barley is winnow it. It is not threshed or beaten, it is winnowed. It is just tossed up into the air, and a gentle breeze is enough to separate the chaff. Barley represents the servants of Christ who are quick to respond to the Spirit working in their heart. And this is the picture that Christ paints in the book of Revelation. All of the letters to the churches, he always ends with, "He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches." The servants of God that are easily moved, they are the barley. Luke 12:37, blessed are those servants whom the Lord, when he cometh, shall find watching. Verily I say unto you that he shall gird himself and make them to sit down to meat, and will come forth and serve them. And if he shall come in the second watch, or come in the third watch, and find them so, blessed are those servants. This is the harvest that Christ wants in our life. He wants to find us barley. He wants us to bring forth fruit. But he wants us to be very responsive to where just the gentle breeze of his word and the Holy Spirit working in our heart and life is all that it takes to move us to what we should be doing and to bring forth fruit in our life. Wheat, on the other hand, though, has to be threshed to separate it from the chaff. This takes a lot more work. And at the harvest time, they have to lay it down on the threshing floor and they have to thresh it. And they run over it with sledges drawn by labor animals. It takes work, and they're threshing it. In fact, the sled that they draw across of it, the bottom has different rocks embedded in it and sharp objects, and they'll pull this over the wheat, and that will help thresh it. The sled itself is even called a tribulum. For doing smaller portions of wheat, you just beat it with a stick. And this is a picture Christ paints in Scripture of his servants who are not responsive to his Spirit's leading. They don't have an ear to hear. They are his servants, they are his offspring, but they're not as responsive. They have to be threshed. And he gives them a warning in light of the end times events in Luke 12:45-48. But, and if that servant say in his heart, My lord delayeth his coming, and shall begin to beat the men servants and maidens, and to eat and drink, and to be drunken. The lord of that servant will come in a day when he looketh not for him, and at an hour when he is not aware, and will cut him in sunder, and will appoint him his portion with the unbelievers. And that servant which knew his lord's will, and prepared not himself, neither did according to his will, shall be beaten with many stripes. But he that knew not and did commit things worthy of stripes shall be beaten with few stripes. Christ wants us to be barley. He does not want us to be wheat. And he tells us ahead of time that the Lord of that servant, who is us, he is returning one day. And he expects us to live in light of it and to bear fruit in our lives and to live so that the world sees Christ in us. But this picture of threshing and beating the wheat is exactly what he's using. And he says the servants who are not watching and living for his return, this is the exact same process that they're going to go through. They're going to be appointed with the unbelievers during the tribulation. This is a court appointment. Our Redeemer, when he returns, he has already known our performance to that point. And the servants that have not lived in light of his coming and prepared themselves, nor lived for things of eternal value, they are going to be appointed with the unbelievers during the tribulation. Because God has to beat out of them the cares of this life. They grew too attached to the things of this life instead of living for what is eternal and for their Savior, their Redeemer. But then there are also tares. Tares look very similar to wheat, but they are actually a completely different plant. Tares are the seed of Satan, and the days of Noah references this and talks about it, the interbreeding that took place before the flood. It's also going to happen in these end times. It'll become a lot more apparent during the tribulation. But they are here. And like scripture mentions, the enemy planted them. They are present in the world, but they are not wheat. They can even appear as ministers of righteousness, though. They can appear as wheat. But later on, closer to harvest, is when the true differentiators become more apparent. Wheat has long tassels, tares do not. They are planted by the enemy Satan, and later on, at the end of the world, these will be gathered and burned. Grapes do not have chaff, but they do have flesh. These are the unbelievers. These will be crushed in the winepress of God's fury at the Battle of Armageddon. When we look on a timeline, we see different stages that will be happening prophetically. And this is very similar to how there are different harvests at different times throughout the year of the different crops. The first harvest that will happen will be of the barley, those who are receptive to the Holy Spirit, those who have an ear to hear what Christ wrote in the letters to the churches. They have made themselves ready. They are watching for their Redeemer. And so when Christ returns for his bride, the one he has redeemed, he will find their lamp shining brightly, and they will be snatched away. The wheat will be left here on the threshing floor to go through the tribulum, the tribulation, because the wheat has to be separated from the chaff. The wheat did not separate itself. It did not purify itself. It did not heed the calls that the Holy Spirit gave in the letters to the seven churches. So it is appointed with the unbelievers and the hypocrites during the tribulation. It is a court appointment. And at the end of the tribulation is the Battle of Armageddon, when God treads the winepress of his fury. At the end of the millennium is what's called the second resurrection. And it is actually two of two resurrections. At the end of the world, after the millennium, that is when all the wheat that died during the tribulation will be resurrected. The great resurrection will be at the end of the millennium. But there is what's called the first resurrection at the end of the tribulation. And it's called the first resurrection. It's one of two. It's when the martyrs, the wheat who did become receptive to the Holy Spirit and was faithful to the end of their course, they are the only ones who will be raised for the millennial time period, and they will rule and reign with Christ 1,000 years. Now, why isn't the dead in Christ rising at the rapture, the bride being snatched away? Why isn't that called a resurrection? Well, really, they're just rising to heaven. It's not technically a resurrection. They're not coming back. They're going to heaven. So really, the first technical resurrection isn't till the end of the tribulation. And so it is the first resurrection. And then at the end of the millennium is the second resurrection. And around that time period is when the New Jerusalem, when the barley, when the bride of Christ is seen in the New Jerusalem. Our Redeemer is returning soon. And so we must ask ourselves the question, how will he find me? Will he find me barley? Or will he find me wheat? Am I receptive to what the Holy Spirit says? Am I in his word? Am I desiring to be as close as I can to Christ? Or am I living as though he delays his coming? In the letters to the seven churches, Christ describes what he is looking for in his bride when he returns. And he calls the churches to have an ear to hear what he has to say. And he says, blessed are those who read it and obey it. So as we await our Redeemer's return, we must purify ourselves. We must judge ourselves so we will not be judged. We must prepare our hearts and our lives so that we will be found of him in peace, without spot, and blameless. Let us run toward Christ. Let us go out to meet him. Let us meet him halfway when he returns, desiring to be as close to him as we can. May Christ find you serving him first and highest above all else. Maranatha.